Last time I told you about the sudden popularity of the square pianos in England, which came up around 1765. And it was a kind of instrument which was invented by Zumpe. Shortly after that, grand pianos were being designed, and it was experimental for a little bit. There's a beautiful America's Becker's piano of 1772 still surviving, and that's the basis of the English piano. And Stoddart and Kirkman and Broadwood were all working on this. And John Broadwood became the most famous of them. And he came around 1760 from Scotland. He was a joiner and a cabinet maker. And he came working for Burcott Shudi. And he was so good that Shudi allowed him to marry his daughter, and he became a partner in business around 1770. He built harpsichords with Shudi up till 1790 around. And they were all signed Burcott Shudi and Johannes Broadwood. And when Broadwood started making only fortepianos, he always signed them Johannes Broadwood. The fortepiano became incredibly popular, and there were so many builders. There was Longman and Broderip, and there was Thomas Tomkison, and a little bit later Clementi, and they all made the most wonderful pianos, all in the same so-called English style, with the English type of action in it, which I will show you later. And then around 1800, it's completely over with the popularity of the harpsichord. The times changed and the music changed and the fashion changed. That's what I always say. And the harpsichords were not used anymore, and there was no music written for them anymore. So there are hardly any left nowadays. I think from Kirkman there are some 100 left, and from Shudi there are some 50 instruments surviving. And that's nothing compared to what the amounts that they produced in the 18th century. Now, here's an early English piano. It's by Broadwood, but it looks like all the English pianos of that period, and it looks like harpsichords of the period and the period just before. It's what the fashion was. So this what the English pianos looked like, and even up till 1825 they looked more or less like this, like a harpsichord. Now, this piano has 5 octaves. 2, 3, 4, 5. Now, something special about the grand pianos is they have pedals. So last time I showed you the early square pianos, they didn't have pedals, which made it a little bit difficult to play. But these pianos have pedals, and actually like the modern piano. So the right pedal is for lifting the dampers. So I'll show you how the dampers work. This is a jack rail, like in the harpsichord, so that the dampers are not being launched out. So here's the damper. It looks exactly like a harpsichord jack. Here's a harpsichord jack. And you can see the idea comes from the harpsichord jack of the dampers. These dampers are original, by the way. It's amazing. So if I push the pedal, all the dampers are being lifted. So you have... This is the English action, the early one, the 1792. It's in a fantastic condition. Never a hammer shank was broken, not anything. How it works? So if I push a key, the hammer is being pushed up. And just before the string, it falls back. So the hammer is not being blocked against the string. And then on the way back, it's being checked. It's a back check. It's a wonderful system. It works fantastically. It repeats very great. And I hope you can see it, that here's a jack which is fixed on the key, hinging, and it pushes the hammer up. It's difficult to see in this within this action, but here's the other key. It's the big key from 1856, but here you can see how it works. So this jack is hinging in the key, and if it pushes the hammer up, which is here, then 2 millimeters for the string, the jack is being pushed away. That's the whole concept of this action. Interestingly enough, all English pianos have this system, and it hardly ever changed in maybe 70 years. So this tiny little hammer, it's a B in the middle. Here's an English hammer. It's exactly the same. It's also a B, but it's a Broadwood of 1856. So it's very much the same, but only the size changes. And here's the key. It's huge by the time. So now this has five octaves, as I explained, and every builder did the same thing at almost the same moment. And strangely enough, in Germany, or Vienna a little bit later, they also had five octaves in the beginning, changing it to 5.5 octaves almost the same moment. So, but the system was very, very, very different. So if I show you a B from this South German action, you can see the hammer hits the other direction. If you see this, it strikes away from you, and this strikes towards you. If I push the key, then there's a little hook taking care that the hammer hits the string. And that's actually all there is in a Viennese action. And also, interestingly enough, they didn't change. Nothing changes in 70 years. Here's a key of 1850. And as you can see, the whole system, the concept is exactly the same. The only thing that changes is that everything gets bigger and heavier. But the whole concept stays the same. Joseph Haydn came to London in the beginning of 1792, and he loved these English pianos, and he wrote the so-called English sonatas for piano. But not only Haydn, also Beethoven got a piano as a present from Broadwood in 1817. It arrived in 1818. Chopin played in Guildford Hall, his last concert on a Broadwood. He loved Broadwoods, but, well, of course, from Chopin's always known that his favorites were the Pleyels. But there were so many famous pianists like Carl Brenner and Clara Schumann and Mendelssohn and Hummel, who all played the English pianos when they were in England for concerts, and they loved them. Thank you. And then there's a short period that, of course, composers and publishers had to sell their music. So if you see music being published, it says for the harpsichord or for the clavichord, the fortepiano, and the small piano, which was a square piano. And after 1800, the harpsichords were not being used anymore, I think. It's difficult to assume what happened to them. They must have been thrown away at some point, these beautiful things, but simply out of fashion. I told you about composers and publishers who wanted to sell their music, and of course this was the transition for 5 octaves till 5.5 octaves, the so-called additional keys. And the music said for 5 octaves or small piano and for the additional keys. And Riko will play a small demonstration of that, a piece by Dussek playing for the 5 octaves piano in this case, and then next on the 5.5. Five and a half octave piano. It's 1807, so it's 15 years later than this one, and it's exactly the same. The concept didn't change at all, but it has more keys and it has a bit thicker hammers and heavier hammers, a bit thicker strings and a thicker soundboard, so it sounds already more romantic. I hope the microphones can pick it up. We don't have great microphones, I'm afraid. So in the 5 octave piano, I told you about having a left pedal. This one also has it, and I didn't explain what it was. But this is a true una corda pedal. It means the pedal, or the whole action can shift from 3 to 1 strings. And interestingly enough, Beethoven uses that in several sonatas, but also in his 4th piano concerto. He got an Erard piano, and Erard built pianos in the way of the English pianos in the beginning. And so that one had a una corda pedal. The Viennese ones didn't have that. So he knew it from the Erard, I would say. Enrico will demonstrate just a few seconds from the 4th piano concerto, where he writes from una corda to due corda to tre corda. Broadwood was a very famous company throughout the 19th century, the whole 19th century, but it existed till far into the 20th century. There's a nice proof of it. There's this brochure of Broadwood with photos and a description how Queen Mary and King George visited the factory in 1926. Broadwood, the piano of the nation for six generations. This is a beautiful brochure with a lot of photos of the Queen and the King looking at the procedure of making soundboards, and it has beautiful, beautiful photos of them. The King and the Queen being fascinated about the work. And in the back of this brochure is a letter from Buckingham Palace, dated the 20th of July 1926. It's a thank you letter saying that the king and the queen desired me to say what pleasure it gave their majesties to go over the works of Messrs. Broadwood and Sons this afternoon. English pianists were very desirable, and in the first half of the 19th century they were almost twice the price of a Viennese piano. But nowadays, pianists prefer playing the Viennese pianos in historical performance practice, which is not unlogical, because the great Mozart and Beethoven and Schubert and Schumann and Brahms all played on Viennese pianos. But it's a bit undeserved, apart from for the English piano, apart from playing Beethoven and Haydn, there are a few very underestimated composers like Pinto and Dussek and Clementi who are wonderful being played on the English piano. This is how far we can tell you about the English piano. In a later stage, we'll tell you about a much bigger Broadwood of 1856, but it's in restoration now, so there's nothing to show about it. You'll get it later, but the next episode will tell you about the Viennese pianos and how important they were.